Good morning, everyone, on this wintry but cold wintry morning. Welcome to our service from the Unitarian Universalist Meeting House in Springfield, Vermont. We welcome those who are zooming in locally from Springfield or elsewhere in the southeast corner of Vermont, as well as those to our extended community who are joining us from afar. We are a multifaceted community, and we're glad you are with us this morning. We are a covenantal community where we have promised to care for and to learn from each other. Together, we seek to deepen and broaden our faith and understanding. Your joining us today will enrich our covenant and our ever-widening community. My name is Jeff Taftick. I'm one of the trustees. If you are a guest with us today, we invite you to simply enjoy being with us. You are welcome to join us after the service for our virtual coffee hour discussion time. At the end of the service, there will be a time for announcements and an opportunity for guests to introduce themselves. Thank you and welcome.
Thank you, Sharon, for sounding the bell for us. And here are these words for the lighting of our chalice. These words are from Thomas Merton, who is a great Catholic priest who passed away in the 1960s. In the end, it is the reality of personal relationships that saves everything. In the end, it's the reality of personal relationships that save everything. We are gathered here today, so glad you're with us, entering a new era in our country and in the world. And what we need more than anything is a shift in our consciousness. We see disruption and challenges around us. And there are also great, great opportunities. So much disruption, so much conflict, so much misunderstanding. But my heart is full of optimism. And it is up to each and every single one of us to figure out what's our part, what's your part? What is your part in healing the relationships that have been disrupted? That's what we're here to explore today. You matter. Each person matters. Each person is special. Each person has something to give that nobody else on the entire planet can give, be, or do what you are here to give and to be and to do. Well, I have a story for you I want to share with you. As some of you know, I do work on countering Islamophobia. I'm wearing my stole. You can't really see it. My stole, which has symbols from the world's religions. So this one, the star and the moon, is Islam. And there's a lot of misunderstanding about Islam. So I've been trying to help people understand Islam a little better. And I went a few years ago to a big, big conference. I mean, big, like 50,000 people in Chicago. It was called the Islamic Society of North America. Islamic Society of North America. I went a few times, and it's called ISNA for short. So it's at a big, big conference hall. And I went to a panel, and I heard a discussion going on, the panel. And one of the reasons that I went was I wanted to see this guy. His name is Zaid Shakir, and he started Zaytuna. It's a Muslim college in California. There are very, very few. This was the first one, Muslim college. And I was just really taken by him for many reasons. He's really articulate and interesting. So he was on this panel. Zaid was on the panel. And there was one woman on the panel who was Jewish. And they're both Americans. Zaid was Jewish, and Deborah was her name. She was Zaid is Muslim, so Zaid is in this religion. And Deborah, where'd it go? Right above it is the Star of David is the religion of Judaism. So they were both on the panel with a few other people. Well, right in the middle of the panel, this teenage boy stands up and he starts yelling at Deborah, and he's really upset. She's Jewish, he's Muslim, and he's really angry. And Zaid, the Muslim guy on the panel, he tried to calm things down. The moderator tried to calm things down, and eventually the panel went on. But afterwards, I went over, people were dispersing, and Zaid was just talking to a few people, and I went over just to hear what he had to say. And the young man who had made the big disruption by yelling, the boy, he was probably maybe 13 or so, he went over and he was talking to Zaid as well. And guess what Zaid said to him? She said, Zaid said to the boy, "You need to go apologize to Deborah." And the boy was upset. He was like, "Wait a minute, what's going on?" Because what the boy was angry about is what's going on in Israel and in Palestine. There had been some fighting and some people had gotten hurt. The Israelis who are in that religion had done some bombing that hurt people in that religion. And so the boy was really angry at Deborah, because she's in this religion, because people in that religion had hurt people in this religion. And so the boy was really angry, but Zaid said to him, "She is our guest here. In this conference, there are 50,000 people of this religion and a handful of people of this religion. And you just yelled at her?" Zaid said, "That's not hospitality. That is not how we treat our guests. You need to go apologize to her." So the boy was really, his head was hanging down. And I said to him, "I'll walk with you. Come on, she's right over there. Let's go do it." And so he and I walked over, and he was kind of grumbling. He's like, "But what's going on? Israel is wrong. It shouldn't be. People are getting hurt, people are dying." But he went over and he started to talk to her. And he had his head down and he was kind of mumbling, and he said, "I just came to say I'm sorry for yelling." And Deborah said to him, "I'm so glad you came here. I'm so glad to be talking to you. We need to talk." And he said, "Well, I don't have time. My mom is outside. She's coming to pick me up. I don't have time to talk right now." And she said, "Here." She pulled out her bag and she said, here's my card, get in touch with me. They lived in very far different parts of the country. And she pulled out of her bag. Well, first she said to him, tell me what you care about. Tell me what you want. And he said, I want people, especially children, to stop being hurt by bombs. That's what the boy said. And Deborah said to him, I want the same thing. Let's work on that. You and me work together to stop the bombs. We're different religions, but we want the same thing. And then she pulled out of her bag some papers and she said, here, take this. And the title on the paper was Having Cool Conversations About Hot Topics. Having cool conversations about hot topics. And what Deborah said to the boy was, this is what I do. This is my work. I travel around and I help people learn how to have cool conversations about hot topics. So please get in touch with me. Here's my card. Here's the cool conversations material. You and I need to work together. And the boy said, I gotta go. My mom's in the car. She's outside waiting for me. I gotta go. And so he took her papers and he took her card and he started to walk away. And I said, I'll walk with you. I'll walk you to the door where your mom is. And so we're walking across this big conference center and he's talking and down the escalators and we're talking. And he said, this has changed my life. This is my life's work. I need to do this. I don't know how, but I need to do this. And he was starting to calm down and he was looking at her material as we're walking and he's kind of fast because he didn't want to be late for his mom. And we said goodbye and he walked out the door and I've never seen that boy again, but I've thought about that story a lot of times. And when you go to a conference, sometimes you think, oh, the big panels and the discussion, you know, the big presentations, that's what's really interesting. But, you know, for me, that little conversation between Zaid and Deborah and the boy didn't happen in the official conference. It happened in the relationships between. And I was so impressed with Zaid. When the boy yelled, he didn't say, go for it. You tell her. He didn't do any of that. He said, calm down. He said, apologize to her. She's our guest. And I so admire him and Deborah. They're mentors. They're leaders. They're the senior people who help young people figure out what to do with the anger, what to do with the upsetness. It's not that it's wrong to be angry. It's what we do with it. And the boy left the conference feeling like he mattered. He had a light to shine in the world, and he wanted to figure out how to do it. That quote I opened with from Thomas Merton, in the end, it is the reality of personal relationships that saves everything. The interaction between Zaid and Deborah and this boy that will save the conflict. So how about you? If you're an adult listening, when you see a young person who's upset, do you fan the flame? Or do you help them calm down and figure out what they can do about what they're upset about? And if you're a kid listening, do you have adults who you can turn to who are like Zaid and Deborah, who can help you not deny your anger? Your anger's real. But help you learn how to have cool conversations about hot topics. Learn how to be cool to make the world a more peaceful place. So we're going to sing a song. We're going to listen to this song. And if you catch it, some of the phrases of it, you're welcome to join in. And I'm going to turn it over to Julaine.
This is a song that was written the day after the inauguration of President Biden by a woman named Leah Morris, who was inspired by the poem The Hill We Climb, which Amanda Gorman recited at that inauguration. So here's Leah. She graciously gave us permission to share her video.
There is always a light when we are ready to see it. There is always a light when we are ready to be it. To see the light, to be the light, to raise our eyes in the dark of night, to climb this hill, together we will. Shine your light in the dark. We are ready to see it. Shine your light in the dark. We are ready to be it. To see the light, to be light, to breathe around now in the dark of night, and be a gift. Together we will. There is always
shine your light.
There is always
in the dark.
We are ready to see it.
There is always
a light.
There is always
in the dark.
We are ready to be it.
To see the light,
to be the light,
to raise our eyes in the dark of night,
and be a gift.
Together we will.
There is always
a light.
There is always
darkness.
There is always
light.
There is always
darkness.
See the light,
to be the light,
to shine our eyes in the dark of night,
and be a climb this hill.
Together
we will.
There is
be
always
the
shine
our
eyes
in the dark.
There is always
shine our eyes
in the dark.
There is always
shine.
Be the
Thank you so much, Julaine. That is a beautiful, beautiful piece, and the choir might be working on it, so we'll hear it again. And many of you heard, if you tuned into the inauguration, you heard Gorman, you heard her beautiful poem that she performed. So it's lovely to see that connection. So shine your light. You've got a light to shine. Let's recite the affirmation together. Love is the doctrine of this church. The quest for truth is its sacrament, and service is its prayer. To dwell together in peace, to seek knowledge in freedom, to serve the needs of all beings, to the end that all souls grow into harmony with the divine. Thus do we covenant with each other and with the source of our being. So as I was listening to the inauguration, I was really interested to hear our new president, Joe Biden, speak. Stop the shouting and cool the temperature. Unity is the path forward. Stop the shouting, cool the temperature. Unity is the path forward. Even before Joe Biden said those words, this was my plan for today's worship service. So when he used those words, I realized we're on the same trajectory here. This flag belongs to my neighbor up the street here, and he got it for Christmas. He's been hanging it outside his house. I've admired it when I go running. And so the other day I popped in and I said, hey, can I borrow your flag for Sunday? And he said, sure, I love it. It says everything, doesn't it? What does it take for us to cool down so that we can hear different perspectives? What does it take to learn how to have cool conversations about hot topics? Avoiding the hot topics will not solve anything, will it? So how can we learn how to have cool conversations? In the Buddhist tradition, which is yet another on my stole, this is the Buddhist wheel. The goal of Buddhism is nirvana. And nirvana means extinguished, like a candle flame blown out. It means calm down, cool down. So the goal of Buddhism is to help us get to that place, that same place, what Zaid was talking about, what Joe Biden's talking about, what Deborah is talking about, learning how to have cool conversations, to get beyond. One of the other, when we are in conflict, there's one position and another position, and you know, here's me and I think I'm right, and there's you and I think you're wrong, and there's nowhere to go with that, right? There's these two warring positions. Nothing can happen. There's no hope. It gets stuck in that. And as a country, we have been stuck into extreme views. We've been polarized. Democrats, Republicans, red, blue. Many of us are wearing purple today to try to get over the polarization and find a new way. Purple is when you mix blue and red together, mix them together, you get purple on the color palette. So how can we get beyond this polarized of Republican, Democrat? How can we get beyond that? This is one of the other religions. This is Taoism, where on the one side, I don't know if you can see it very clearly, but there's black on one side and white on the other, and each of the black has a dot of white in the middle, and the white has a dot of black in the middle. And it's like, it's not static. It's like the black and the white are flowing together. It's dynamic. Can you see that? So it's not just black against white. It's a recognition that the black has a dot of white in it, and the white has a dot of black in it. Two polarized sides can go nowhere, but if we can find a relationship where we can intertwine and realize, okay, you're on that side and I'm on that side, but there's a dot of inside of you that is very similar to me and in me that is similar to you, and how can we find that commonality? That's what Deborah did in that story that I shared with you from when I went to the Islamic Society of North America. When the boy was upset, she said to him, "What do you care about? What do you want?" And he said, "I want nobody to get hurt anymore. I want no more bombs." And she said, "I want the same thing." So rather than it being the Jews against the Muslims, she tried to find this. Yeah, you're other, but we're similar. The love inside of you is the same love inside of me. How do we be in relationship with each other? That's the big challenge right now, isn't it? And there's so much that is polarizing us. This is our job. No matter what side you were on in the election right now, if you were on the side that won, you're really happy and you're joyful with all your friends who are happy. If your side lost, you're miserable and you're upset and you're angry, and all of your friends are upset and angry. Just because one side won, the work is not over. As Joe Biden said, this is our job. Let's work on the path to unity. Stop the polarization and find the way to relate and connect. And in order to do this, we need to understand, how did we get here? What happened? What happened? And it's very complicated, isn't it? There are many levels that brought us to this place where we are not cool, where we are fighting, where we are polarized. And one of the ways that we got here is through social media.
When you go to Google and type in climate change is, you're going to see different results depending on where you live and the particular things that Google knows about your interests.
That's not by accident. That's a design technique.
What I want people to know is that everything they're doing online is being watched, is being tracked. Every single action you take is carefully monitored and recorded.
A lot of people think Google's just a search box and Facebook's just a place to see what my friends are doing. What they don't realize is there's entire teams of engineers whose job is to use your psychology against you.
I was the co-inventor of the Facebook-like button.
I was the president of Pinterest.
Google.
Twitter. Instagram.
There were meaningful changes happening around the world because of these platforms. I think we were naive about the flip side of that coin.
We get rewarded by hearts, likes, thumbs up, and we conflate that with value and we conflate it with truth.
A whole generation is more anxious, more depressed.
I always felt like fundamentally it was a force for good. I don't know if I feel that way anymore.
Facebook discovered that they were able to affect real world behavior and emotions without ever triggering the user's awareness. They are completely clueless.
Fake news spreads 6 times faster than true news. We're being bombarded with rumors.
If everyone's entitled to their own facts, there's really no need for people to come together. In fact, there's really no need for people to interact.
We have less control over who we are and what we really believe.
If you want to control the population of your country, there has never been a tool as effective as Facebook.
We built these things and we have a responsibility to change it. The intention could be, how do we make the world better?
If technology creates mass chaos, loneliness, more polarization, more election hacking, more inability to focus on the real issues, we're toast.
This is checkmate on humanity.
That film is called Social Dilemma. You just saw the trailer for it. We showed it and we have a monthly movie. First Friday film series, and that was one of the ones we showed last year. It's time to look at it again, I think. So we're going to have a film discussion on that film, Social Dilemma. I really encourage you to take a look at it. And the guy with the red hair in that film, his name is Tristan Harris, and he has a TED Talk, which is really great. And so if you don't want to rent the film, look at Tristan Harris's TED Talk, and I have all of this, all the links on a handout, I'll show you in a little bit, and then we'll also send it out tomorrow. It can be overwhelming to realize this. A few years back, when I started to realize how we are being used and manipulated, you know, this eye that I look into here, it's looking at me and it's measuring me, and what shows up on my screen, what it pulls me into, it's not by chance. There are algorithms behind it all. And as they said so clearly in that trailer and in that movie, we're being manipulated. And this situation that we are in this country of the red against the blue, this polarization, it's never been so bad. And it is the product of this technology. The technology could be designed in a very different way. It's not a given. The guy with the red hair, Tristan Harris, he's an ethicist. Google had an ethicist. That's his job, to figure out how do we create technology that is ethical. It's out of hand. We need to get it back in hand. Many, many of states now have antitrust lawsuits against Facebook and others, because people are starting to wake up and realize that this situation that we're in of polarization is in part the result of that. But it's not hopeless. We're not helpless. We can find ways, and people are working on ways to use this technology for the good, because that's not what it's being used for right now. It's being used to create what we have been witnessing. Such pain, such polarization. No ground, no common ground for discussion. And as Thomas Merton says, it's the reality of personal relationships that will save us. That's what we need. We need connection. We don't need more pulling people apart. Have you had an opportunity to be in conversation with Biden supporters? What's in their hearts and minds? Do you know? Well, one of the things that is on the hearts and minds of Trump supporters is the economic disparity, the feeling of hopelessness, and the incredible disruptions that are happening in people's lives, including climate justice issues. And there's so much that we can do and learn. And I want to suggest that we do this together, that we read the book, Hillbilly Elegy. It's now been made into a movie, so you can watch or watch the movie. And there's the author of it is J.D. Vance. The Hillbilly Elegy is a wonderful book. This is a person who grew up in Kentucky in a really difficult situation, and he was able to escape. And he actually ended up becoming a lawyer. I forget if he went to Harvard or Yale. But hearing, it's his memoir. Out of that pain of economic disparity, out of that hopelessness, people are looking for a savior. They're looking for someone who can help. And some people thought they could find it in Trump. Can you understand this? Do you have compassion for this situation? If not, this is an opportunity. This is the work that we need to do. So let's start here. There's lots that we can do. And so much of what's at the root of our challenges is the unresolved stuff that we have in this country around race and trauma and our Civil War legacy. And here's some resources. These are things that we are doing and are going to continue to do. There's a series called Seeing White podcasts that are really excellent. There's about 12 of them. They're about 15 minutes long. So we're going to have a series where we can get together, listen to the podcast, and talk together about them. We've also been working with the book My Grandmother's Hands, Racialized Trauma, and which is really excellent. And we're also going to bring in a speaker from the Vermont Humanities, Jane Williamson, to talk to us about abolition. She's an incredible abolition historian. And one of the questions is, how did we get here? How did we get here to this position? What's the draw of authoritarianism? How does fascism raise its ugly head? And Kayum, who is one of the art monks, he is getting together a discussion group to try to understand, looking at Timothy Snyder's book, The Road to Unfreedom, and trying to understand fascism and authoritarianism. When we are in this attitude of us and them, there's no hope. The other is other, and there's no way of connecting. What we need is a shift of consciousness. What Zaid and Deborah did with that boy is to say, let's not be in this polarized position. Let's find a common ground. Let's transcend. Because when you do, when you interact with someone who you think of as other, or someone who appears different than you, and you find a common ground, it's wonderful. It's truly wonderful. If we judge people on their appearances or on their political party, we continue the polarization. But how to transcend that and find opportunities for connection? Back to Buddha and Nirvana. So Nirvana in Buddhism, in that religion, Nirvana is that place of blown outness, of being cool, of extinguished, like a flame being blown out. That's what happens. So in our ordinary states of consciousness, we're in this conflict and ego-driven other, me against them. But there are other ways of being in the world. There are other ways of being, transcendent ways, where our consciousness can be raised so we're not stuck in this polarized, but that it's like being on a balcony where you can look down and see what's going on. When you're in this, you can't see anything. All you see, here's me and here's them, and I'm right and they're wrong. No hope there. But what about a balcony view where you can look down and say, oh, look, look at yourself and say, okay, so I believe this. These other people believe that. How can we find commonality here to be able to blow out the ego, to be cooled down enough so that you can get a balcony view and look down and see it? What's possible? This is where spiritual practices are essential. Most of us can't do this very easily. We get caught in our own, well, this is what happened to me, and this is how I think, and this is the way I see it, which is fine. But it's only a small part of the world to be able to transcend and take in more than your little ego, because your ego is only a small part of you. You have a great consciousness. Most of us don't use it much. So what do we need to do to help heal this divide? We need to shift our consciousness. And what we need is to engage in our spiritual practices, to cool down enough. That's what spiritual practices do, and there's lots of them. I've shared this with you a few weeks ago, I think, this poem by Rumi. Out beyond the ideas of wrongdoing and rightdoing, there's a field. I'll meet you there. When the soul lies down in that grass, the world is too full to talk about. Ideas, language, is even the phrase each other doesn't make sense anymore. Out beyond the ideas of right and wrong, there's a field. I'll meet you there. That's what we need. And it's our spiritual practices that can help us transcend the ego, this right-wrong thinking, into a more expansive way of being. And there are many, many spiritual practices. Here I'm highlighting some of them on the screen. Tai Chi, praying, meditating, singing meditation, yoga, dancing, being in nature, breathing, art, so many. What is it for you? Do you have spiritual practices? Do you do them regularly? Because if you don't, you're caught in this polarized yuck. And it feels terrible. But in our spiritual practices, we can transcend and get out of this ego nonsense and see the reality that we are all one humanity. And find the places. What do you want? I want it too. Like Deborah said to the boy. Yes, I also do not want the bombs, do not want people to be hurt. So when we transcend, we can find solutions. And our spiritual practices help us get there. So what are your spiritual practices? And what opportunities do you have or have you created for being in loving dialogue with people who are different than you? And if you cannot cool down enough for these dialogues, that's a huge challenge. I want to give, I'll come back to that in a second. I just want to give, Steve Crofter had a really wonderful idea. So Deb, would you, Steve, if you could unmute yourself and make some noise, then Deb can find you.
Yeah, here we are.
There we are. So Steve had a great idea of one of the ways that we could address this. So share with us your idea, Steve, if you would.
Okay, well, I think it's certainly been a long time in coming for me. You know, literally, probably a matter of years. But I've also been listening to things that Mellon's been saying over the last period of time, urging us in this direction. But just the idea of listening to one another, and especially across the political divide between conservatives and liberals. I'm inspired in part by my brother. He lives down in Virginia. He's politically very liberal, but all his friends are conservative. He's a motorcycle riding member of the Moose Club, and he's the only liberal in the Moose Club there. And I've just been inspired by his ability to have friends who who have really different political beliefs than he does. And then also just lately in the Friends on the Path group, we've been talking about this, and that's been really helpful to me. So what I did just recently was to put out a notice on Front Porch Forum and a letter to the editor of the local paper, inviting people to join me in a group with the idea that we would, you know, perhaps become friends, but at least listen to one another enough to understand where each other was coming from across the political divide. And I think partly my thinking is, well, I'm trying to set it up so that none of us, or as few as possible, don't know what other people's political leanings are before we get started getting to know one another. And I'm actually going to use a third party, my brother in this case, to be the one to set up, to make sure, set up the group to make sure that we have roughly equal numbers between conservatives and liberals. But then to get to know one another sort of before we concentrate on our political differences, to get to know one another as people. And to learn, and then to kind of go for what do we really care about? Like in Mellon's story just now about the boy whose real concern was that children be safe from bombing. You know, that's a positive aspiration, safety. And what's behind our political beliefs before we share our positions? What do we want? And then finally, eventually when we do know each other's political leanings, like even if we can't agree with the other person, we can hopefully understand where they're coming from. What is it in their backgrounds that led them to grow with that aspiration, with that belief? So anyway, that's what I'm hoping for. And I've got eight or 10 people so far that are interested in being part of this group. And we're hopefully going to get started. And I don't know if we're evenly divided yet or not, but hopefully we will be. So that's, thanks.
Wonderful. Thanks so much, Steve, for that idea. And I also saw online doing something similar, but just pairs, matching up a liberal and a conservative, and you get a pair mate, and you get to interact and get to know each other, which I've signed up for. I'll try it out. If it seems good, I'll share that link with you as well. So look for opportunities for conversations. And if you can't, be cool. That means you're being triggered. That means there's some trauma in you. There's something in you that your ears are shut down for the moment because you're too upset to hear. And that's okay. Notice. That's the first step. Notice. Notice that you are being triggered. Notice that I cannot hear a word this person is saying because I'm just reacting and I'm starting to hear something they're saying and wah! Notice that's going on in you. There's something inside of you that is feeling upset and hurt that has closed your mind and your ears. Okay. This book that many of us have been reading and working with, My Grandmother's Hands, the subtitle is Racialized Trauma and the Pathway for Our Healing. Because when negative things happen, they land in our body. That's where they are. Your past traumas, they're in your body. And we have intergenerational trauma. That's part of our huge problem as a country. We are the inheritors of the legacy of the Civil War. We are the inheritors of a society that was built on slavery and racial injustice, economic injustice. We're a society that was built on the abuse of many, many immigrant populations, the degrading of many people, and it doesn't go away. What scientists know now is called epigenetic trauma, where the trauma from our past generations, it's in you, it's in your body, and it keeps you from being able to be cool and have cool conversations about hot topics because the trauma is in you. And when you hear it, you get triggered. So what Resma teaches and what I want to just do right now, let's just do a little meditation. So I invite you to close your eyes for a minute and take a breath. Feel your feet on the floor. Feel your body being held in your chair if you're sitting. And just breathe. Just do a scan of your body. Notice what you're feeling. Are there areas of tension in your body? As you've been hearing the stories and the music, the reflections in this service, where did it land in your body? Notice in your heart, your gut, your jaw, your back. Where is it for you? Just breathe into those places or that place in your body where you feel some energy or some tension. Be gentle with yourself. If it would help you, you can gently put your hand on that part of your body where you're feeling the impact of this message. And just breathe into that part of your body and see what's there. Be gentle. And as you are sitting in gentle witness of your own body and your own heart and mind, let's just say a prayer together. Spirit of life, the source, the one, thank you so much for the gift of this beautiful winter day. And thank you for the gift of this beloved community that has gathered online. And thank you for this opportunity for each of us to figure out our part in healing the disruptions in our country. Thank you for our bodies, each of us, our body, and the wisdom that is there, the feelings that are there that can be a gateway, an opening to new growth. Thank you for all of the people who are doing their best to calm down and listen and show us the way collectively. And thank you so much for each of our individual lives and each of our individual lights, each of us doing our part to heal the world. Great Spirit, send your light, your love, your healing, your ease through our bodies, our hearts, and our minds. Heal us and strengthen us that we may be vehicles of love and light and healing in this beautiful world. May it be so, blessed be. Amen. Now take a breath again and stay with your body. Notice what you're feeling. When you're ready, you can open your eyes gently, shake a little bit if that helps you, and just look around, take in the world. These simple practices of presence and breathing, they're very profound. Sometimes it can be deceptive how something as simple as what we just did It can heal us. It really does. Having been a practitioner of these embodied practices for many, many years, decades, I know this to be true. I know I used to be a lot more angry. I know I used to not be able to cool down at all. But now I can. In spiritual practices, including this kind of calm meditation and presence with your own body, this is a gateway to healing, and certainly prayer. And if you don't know how to pray yet, it's an invitation to learn how to do that. And connecting with ancestors, the trauma of our past, and the blessing, the wisdom of our past, these are all practices that can help us shift our consciousness so we can be part of the healing, not stuck in the polarizedness, but transcending so we can look down with a loving, open heart and take in the brokenness and do our part to heal it. So this is what we're going to be up to in the next 6 months or so. And this is my hope. Let's do it again. Let's learn about social media and how it's polarizing us. Let's talk about it. Let's change our own use of social media practices. Let's learn about the supposed other, what's going on in our country with climate and economic injustice. Let's look at race and trauma and the Civil War legacy and how did we get to this place of fascism. Let's engage in our spiritual practices so that we can cool down and listen and take it all in. And if you feel inclined to join Steve and his project, please do so. And this is our destination. When we can get back together, we're going to gather virtually and in person at the Weathersfield Meeting House. What you see, this is a Civil War memorial. Right in front of the meeting house. And it's a great opportunity. We're going to gather right around here, and we're going to be on Zoom as well. We're going to do a healing service and share how we have grown and changed, what we have learned, how we have learned how to transcend and not get stuck in this, and we've had conversations with the supposed other, how we have learn to be more of a master and less of a victim of social media. So we're going to gather online and in person at the meeting house around the Civil War Memorial, having each of us done our part in healing this great divide and bringing ourselves and our country into alignment with who we really are and the greatness that we can be. So what's your part? How can you let your light shine? In a couple of weeks, Karis Boak is going to be in the pulpit. She's going to be our guest, and she's going to talk about our ancestors and creating an altar to connect with our ancestors. It's partly about racialized trauma and trauma, and it's also about inherited wisdom. So that's part of the puzzle. So I hope you'll join us and continue in these next 6 months or so, however long, before we can be together in Weathersfield. If you don't have a spiritual practice yet, this is an opportunity to explore it so that you can learn how to be cool, so that you can be a vehicle of love and peace in this beautiful world that needs you. So back to those words that I opened with from Thomas Merton. In the end, it is the reality of personal relationships that will save us. Away from the polarized into relationship. that will save us. And you're a part of it. May it be so. Blessed be. Amen. Let's sing our song. Extinguish the chalice and do our bell. So, Sharon. And the words are from President Joe Biden. Stop shouting and cool the temperature. Unity is the path forward. Cool the temperature. Unity is the path forward. Sharon?